So there's an article published in Healio, which is a medical online journal, titled "Ultra-Processed Food Linked to Risk for Heart Disease and Stroke." Yeah, no kidding. So it's not that we didn't know this before, but it's interesting that in the medical journals now it's popping up, because until now, you know, the medical journals have been a bit protective, in my opinion, of the food industry. And the food industry wants to produce items that have a very long shelf life, you know, and that is achieved in the ultra processing of foods. You know, it makes them last a lot longer. Also, seed oils are a big part of processed foods. We're talking about soybean oil, canola oil, and so on. And when you read labels of any processed foods, there's tons of seed oils in there. As a matter of fact, which was interesting, McDonald's until the 1990s, I believe, they used beef tallow, which is just rendered beef fat, for their french fries, which tasted a lot better and arguably was a lot healthier, because this is a saturated fat. You know, it doesn't really denature, it doesn't break down into toxic products like when you heat up these polyunsaturated fats from seed oils, which we're using now. So in the 1990s, there was so much push against McDonald's to start going with the healthier plant-based oils that they switched to seed oils. And now, of course, everything's fried in soybean oil there, which is makes it terribly disgustingly unhealthy and even toxic, in my opinion. But to this day, when you look at the American Heart Association, they're still pushing seed oils. They're saying, yeah, don't eat all that butter and all that stuff. You know, have your soybean and canola oil, much better for you, because it can lower your LDL cholesterol. Now, these oils, again, my issue, and I talk about this frequently, is how they're produced. A lot of them are chemically extracted, and then they need to be deodorized and clarified and bleached. That's a really bad process. Some of them are expressed a little bit better, but all of them are extremely high in omega-6 fats. And the issue with that is that our ratio is way off. Today, it's closer to 20 to 1, omega-6 to omega-3. It used to be 1 to 1 in our hunter-gatherer times. And these oils are very bad for mitochondria. They clog up the mitochondria. We don't process them. We don't burn them very easily. And they cause mitochondrial dysfunction and disease. So when you look at the onset of us consuming these heavily in the 1960s, 70s, and so on, and then we increase this every year. So today we're using a lot of these. And you see a correlation, a major correlation to our increase in heart disease, cancer, autoimmune disorders, and so on. So there's a direct link, at least. It's a correlation, I know, but it's a very strong one. So anyway, they're writing here again with the ultra-processed fruits. They have some key takeaways here. High intake of ultra-processed fruits was linked with cardiovascular disease, coronary heart disease, and stroke risk. Again, kind of knew this, right? And this was mediated when processed meats, and of course, they don't like meats, by the way. So all the medical journals don't like meats. Now, I would agree with them that processed meats are not very good. But it's not just the meat itself. When you talk about processed meats, they're talking about pepperoni, pizza, and hot dogs. And then what are we talking about here? We're talking about also the dough and all these other things in there and how their cheeses are made. And there's a lot of seed oils in these, right? So when we look at processed meats, a lot of times this doesn't even mean the meat. And I think the meat component is the least of our worry in those. So in your pepperoni pizza, that these few pieces of salami, I think, is probably the healthiest thing in the whole thing. The rest is crap. But if you leave those out, if you leave out the processed meats and the sugar sweetened drinks, and I totally agree with that one, because we're drinking way too many calories, and I talk about that frequently. We can drink a lot more calories than we can eat. So if you leave those two things out, you did better, significantly better, according to them. So they're saying your high consumption of ultra-processed foods, especially processed meats, sugar sweetened drinks, was associated with this increased risk that they found. And they looked at U.S. cohorts to study this. So they looked at three groups of people where they could get data from, right? And they're saying here in the United States, ultra-processed foods represent 57% of the adult population's energy intake. Now imagine that. More than half of the daily energy intake is coming from ultra-processed foods with all the crap in there. We're talking about preservatives, seed oils. We're talking about food coloring agents. We're talking about all the things that preserve stuff, and also the way it's made, the way it is that we extend this shelf life. That's 57% of the U.S. Adult population's energy intake. That's extremely scary, in my opinion. And of course, they're saying here this is mass-produced whole grain, vitamin-fortified breads. They put a lot more than just vitamins in there, you know, artificial vitamins, but there's a lot of ingredients in there and preservatives that are very questionable and that are actually not allowed in some other countries. In Europe, many of these are banned, but we're putting a bunch of crap in there. That's why our bread lasts so long and is so fluffy. Two, nutritionally devoid soft beverages. Absolutely agree. That's crap already. And these are associated, again, with higher cardiovascular disease. So very interesting. So they looked at three cohorts. They had a total of, I think, 200,000 people that they looked at. They looked at data cohorts. So people that fill out questionnaires over many years, and they can go back into that and say, okay, these people ate this, these people ate this. How did they do? So you can't do a prospective, you can't do a study, hey, starting today, I'm going to have one group eat this and one group eat that. That also wouldn't be ethically feasible because we know how bad some of these foods are. So they just went back to these cohorts, and they had the nurses' health study, the nurses' health study two, and then they also had the health professionals' follow-up study. And it's, again, total of about 200,000 people, which is a decent amount of number. And I think this went over about 30 years. I'm going to have to find it in here. But so they looked at data for quite some time, 32 years, which is, I think, fine, and that's the way to do it. You look at this, you see what are the differences in the nutrition. The problem is always based on questionnaires. And again, we've had this before where we vilified meat because we said, hey, these guys ate meat and look, they're sick. But if you put in pizza and hot dogs as a meat eater, that's not the same as someone eating grass-fed beef twice a week or having a steak three times a week, That's a very different thing. Also keep in mind, a lot of times people eating that processed food and the pizza and the hot dogs all the time, they might consume alcohol, they might be smoking and all these things. So these are all things that we have to keep in mind here, right? So that's why there's inherently some issue with some of these data, and there's some issues using a study like this, but that's the best we have. We got to do questionnaires. The other thing is, of course, people lie because they know, hey, pizza is not good for me. Maybe I'm not going to put down, I'm eating five pizzas a week, right? So is this data perfect? No. But even with this imperfect data, they found, hey, if you eat crap, not very good, right? So again, over a median follow-up over 32 years, participants in the highest quintile of ultra-processed foods intake experienced an approximately 11% greater risk for cardiovascular disease, 16% greater risk for coronary heart disease, and 4% greater risk for stroke compared with the lowest quintile, so people that ate the least junk food. And that's hugely significant. I mean, that's just based on these data. We can see that you get a lot sicker. You die from heart disease and other issues if you eat crap. And again, we knew this. My surprise is only that the industry is now allowing us to publish this in medical journals, because again, they still will not talk about CDOS, I guarantee you, in this article. But, again, it's going in the right direction. And of course, they talked about the reduction here where you get better when you reduce some of these things, right? So anyway, they conclude here, specifically our findings suggest soft drinks and processed meats. Again, regular meat is fine, but, processed meats, you're talking about the other crap associated with it, should be discouraged, given their consistent adverse association with coronary vascular disease, coronary heart disease, and stroke, they wrote. Reducing the content of sodium, saturated fats, they always vilify the saturated fats. I don't think saturated fats are an issue. In moderation, fat has a lot of calories. I always discourage taking in too much of them, but I much rather people eat butter than they eat seed oils. But they don't agree with that, of course, because, that's the medical establishment at this point. Added sugars, no question, don't add sugars to anything. And cosmetic additives. And that's stuff like titanium dioxide. This stuff has no business in our foods. They put it in there to look pretty, and it certainly has a lot of other problems associated with it, and we don't need it, right? In Europe, that's actually not allowed. Non-essential for human health. Now, in whole grain bread, cold cereals, and some savory snacks may enhance the otherwise nutritional value of these products in the US. So again, they don't go into, well, we don't like these oils and all, these seed oils and all that. They won't say that, but at least I think they can agree on that in general, ultra-processed foods, So foods that are prepared to last a very long time and are nutritionally devoid because of the way they're prepared are not good for us and are linked to disease. And again, this is in contrast to a few articles that were published recently where said, we don't have a lot of evidence that this stuff is bad for us. My concern, again, is that the food industry is heavily influencing the medical industry. We are still promoting seed oils, which I mentioned before, I have a big problem with. I think that's not appropriate. We only need very little of these. We're eating way too much of these. The correlation is huge with disease onset from the time that we start using those. But interesting that they're now at least admitting this much. I think this is a step in the right direction. I hope that there's more articles like this that are talking about, hey, if you leave out all that stuff, you get better. Because what are we pushing these days? When you look at all the medical journals, what they're pushing right now is stuff like Ozempic, semaglutide, all these things. Hey, look, this works for fat loss. This is amazing. People lose, and guess what? Their blood pressure gets better. And guess what? Their kidney functions get better. Yeah, no shit, that's because when you are losing weight, things get better. What they don't talk about when you use some of these GLP-1 agonists, you know, you're losing a lot of muscle mass. 50% of the weight loss is muscle mass loss, which is horrible. Also, these medications come with a black box warning because in rodent studies, it's been shown to cause thyroid cancer, right? It causes a 400% increase in pancreatitis. It causes a huge increase in the issue how we're digesting food and slowing the digestion. Gastric paralysis, which can sometimes be surgical issues associated with it, and so on. There's some eye issues. I mean, these are, again, they're not talking about any of that. They're saying, well, which one should we choose? There's Mounjaro, all nice names, by the way. Then there's Ozempic or Wegovy. You know, there's all these wonderful different ones. Let's use that, and that cures the whole thing. No. So, again, also then we have this massive loss of muscle mass. It is so extreme that now there's cosmetic surgery in the face, or you have fillers injected because you get this Ozempic face when you use these things. There's rapid weight loss. There's no nutritional advice. Usually it's just that you just eat the standard American diet, you're fine. Consume your seed oils, lose that weight, and then we'll fix you up. So at least this is a good step in the right direction, because now we're saying, hey, these foods itself, they cause actual disease. So we should weed them out, you know. They don't talk so much about weight loss here. This is more specific towards, cardiac disease mostly and stroke. But I think it's good that they're mentioning this. I hope there's more articles like this. And I think we're hopefully getting away from getting these ideas of getting a medication as a fix for an obesity problem that we have that is really founded on our poor nutritional intake. And if we get back to our roots in terms of consuming whole foods, you know, unprocessed foods, organic foods, as we've done about 100 years ago, I think we'll be a lot healthier.